thank you very much. Are we on?
Yep.
All right, we're live. All right, thank you all very much for coming to the late session. I hope the time is well spent. I understood this, Professor Sullivan used my normal slot. Now, where we left off the last time was on Hanna. And we're talking about Hanna Part 1. Okay? So, the thing we have to think about is how does Hanna modify the York test? York, as you'll recall, looks to whether or not there's going to be a substantial difference in the outcomes if we apply state law as opposed to federal law. Well, that test was too quick to find we need to use state law. So what Hanna does is it modifies the York outcome determination test. And where we left off was on the twin aims of Erie. So this is within Hanna 1. This is going to be on page 939. Justice Earl Warren says the outcome determination test of York can't be read without reference to the twin aims of Erie, number one, discouragement of form shopping, and number two, preventing the inequitable administration of laws. All right, let's look at the first of these two twin aims. Preventing form shopping. What kind of form shopping might occur if we use federal law over state law? Who would engage in form shopping?
So whoever, the plaintiff, if he wants to have the case.
Yeah, the plaintiff, if the plaintiff wants to file in federal court as opposed to state court. Might a defendant ever engage in form shopping?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
In what case might a defendant engage in form shopping? Yes?
If they have an option to remove.
If the defendant has an option to remove. So here I refer you back to the handout that I previously assigned, right? The one talking about the due process problems arising from hearing. And we note that in some circumstances, only the plaintiff will determine what form we're in. In some circumstances, both have the power. A litigant who has the most power to form shop is going to be an out-of-state defendant suing an in-state defendant on the basis of diversity, right? So when is somebody going to engage in forum shopping? At the time of trial, after trial, or before trial?
Before,
right? In the case of a plaintiff, when the plaintiff files, chooses state or federal court. In the case of a defendant, when the defendant files a notice of removal, right? So in other words, it's going to be a forward-looking thing. It's going to be a litigant making a choice before the litigation actually unfolds as to which form they want to make. Now think about my hypo with the red and blue briefs, right? Is a litigant likely to choose federal court as opposed to state court because federal court would require, say, blue briefs instead of red briefs? That's not likely to, it's not likely to motivate someone to either be in federal court or to remove to federal court. It could be outcome determinative in the York sense, but it's not going to affect litigation behavior in the sense of which forum do I want to be in. So that's an example of how the test of York has been modified to make it a little less state-friendly. Now what about the second aim of Erie? Preventing or avoiding the inequitable administration of laws. What does the court, it's a question of the class, what might the court mean by the word inequitable in the phrase inequitable administration of the laws? Yes?
Like unfair? Like if it would be unfair to vote?
Yeah, I quite agree, Shanae. About unfairness, right? The sense of unfairness that you would have a different result in state court versus federal court. And again, requiring, say, blue briefs in federal court doesn't seem to be particularly fair, even if state courts would use red briefs. What about the facts of Hanna itself? Is it unfair that the rules of service in federal court might be different from what is required by state court. Here the court doesn't seem to think that would be a problem, right? If you're a plaintiff filing in federal court, you could use the federal rule. And if you're a defendant who might be sued in federal court, that means in addition to checking in various places, you might have to check at home to see if anybody has served an adult who resides at your home, at your usual place of abode. So here the court isn't thinking there's going to be form shopping and doesn't think there's going to be some sort of deep unfairness that would matter. So even though the application of the federal law here would lead to a different result, even though application of the federal law here would be outcome determinative in a York sense, the court nevertheless says that if we were to use a modified York test, that would not here require the use of state law over federal law because it wouldn't lead to form shopping and it wouldn't be unfair in a way that would lead to the inequitable administration of the laws. Now, this portion of the Erie case, Hanna 1, does it decide the outcome of the case? No, it's dicta, right? And the reason it's dicta is what the court talks about, I believe it's on the next page, where the court says, there is a more fundamental flaw in the respondent's syllogism, blah, 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 blah. The court points out this dispute, the actual dispute in this case, is not between state law on one hand and judge-made federal law on the other hand. It is instead between state law and an REA rule. In other words, an FRCP rule created under the Rules Enabling Act. Now, let me share something with you that's extremely important. Hanna Part 1 is dicta within the four corners of the Hanna case itself. However, Hanna 1 is the law. Hanna 1 is the way that we evaluate a conflict between state law and between judge-made federal procedure law that's not contained in the Constitution, a statute, or an FRCP, or some other REA rule. And we see several examples of courts using Hanna Part 1 to analyze such a conflict. First, we see the Walker case. Walker is analyzed using the twin aims approach. Second, we see in dissent Justice Ginsburg using the twin aims approach to analyze the conflict between federal law and Section 901B in the Shady Grove case. All right, so that is the law for handling disputes between federal judicial practice, right, judge-made procedural law, and state law. However, Hanna itself is analyzed under the Rules Enabling Act. So let's spend a few minutes talking about the REA. Now, when we talk about REA, we're not talking about the RDA. The RDA is the Rules of Decision Act, Section 1652. That's what was being interpreted in the Erie case itself, right? In fact, the line of cases running from Erie to York to Byrd to Hanna Part 1 to Walker, those are cases that are applying the Rules of Decision Act in one way or another. Hanna Part 2 involves the Rules Enabling Act, that's Section 207.2 of the Judicial Code. And look what it does. It says the Supreme Court has the power to prescribe rules of practice and procedure for cases in the U.S. District Courts and so on and so forth. Then it goes on to say that such rules shall not abridge, enlarge, or modify any substantive right. That's the Rules Enabling Act. This act is a big deal. This act was created to allow the Supreme Court to create the FRCP. So this act predates 1938. There's a bunch of connected acts, such as 207.3, 207.4, 207.7, etc., that flesh out how the process works. Now, in your case book after the Hanna case, I forget the case number, the page number, but on page 945, you have a little graphic that shows the rulemaking process. So, when FRCP rules are created, first they go to an advisory committee that drafts them, and there's opportunities for public comment and participation. The advisory committee also drafts notes that oftentimes end up being comments to newly adopted rules or amendments to rules. If something gets through the advisory committee, then goes to the judicial conference, and then to the Supreme Court. And if the Supreme Court approves any such rule or any amendment to a rule, it then goes to the U.S. Congress. And Congress has 7 months to reject the rule. And I say that specifically. Congress has one role there. It's not to accept the rule, it's to reject the rule. So if Congress does nothing, the rules go into effect 7 months after they're transmitted to Congress by the Chief Justice. If Congress does not like a rule or an amendment to a rule, then Congress can pass a bill rejecting or modifying a plan, rule, or an amendment to a rule. Typically, Congress doesn't do that. Typically, Chief Justice Roberts will send any amendments to Congress. Nothing happens, and 7 months later, they go into effect. That's what happened last year, right? I believe it's in May that the Chief sent the new rules to the Congress, and then on December 1st, 2015, the day after your final exam, various changes to a bunch of rules went into effect. All right. So what the court does in Hanna Part 2 is analyze this case not as a modified twin aims case, but instead as an REA conflict. Now, what I want us to do now is look at the Hanna case and tell me how does Chief Justice Warren analyze the dispute. Let's start off with our new 2L senators. Stephanie, let's start with you.
Okay. If you want to look on page 944, it explains Chief Justice Warren's opinion a little bit in section 3. It's in like the, I don't have to click it right there.
No, you don't want to go on 944.
Oh, I don't?
No, what's 944?
It's just kind of, it explains in part 1.
But is that part of the opinion? Yeah, I don't want to know what Glennon has to say. I want to know what Stephanie has to say.
Okay, so what he does is he, let me go in my thoughts really quick. On Hanna 1, you said?
Are we on Hanna 1 or Hanna 2?
I'm confused. I didn't actually hear the whole question. Hanna 2? Okay.
Hanna 2. How does the court analyze Hanna 2?
Okay, they go through it and they kind of, they can, it says that they, conclude that the adoption of Rule 4D was, it didn't exceed the congressional means. They found that it wasn't invalid, so it pretty much, it was the correct thing to do. It didn't necessarily have to, they said it was like the right procedure that didn't really affect the outcome.
Hmm.
So that it wasn't, at least that's what I understood from it.
What page should we be looking at?
I'm looking at 937, the first part of it. It says that...
Okay, fair enough. 937, okay.
Yeah, it says 4D was in line with the REA, is what I have in my notes.
Well, what's interesting about this part of the opinion, down to here, is that's part of Hanna 2, okay? That's part of the Rules Enabling Act analysis. So what do we have on pages 937 to 38, Stephanie? What does the court tell us?
It also, it says the Rules Enabling Act pretty much gives the Supreme Court the power to prescribe the general rules.
Okay, well that's what the Act says itself,
that,
right?
Yeah, that it shouldn't, it goes into the amount of redeeming the law.
Okay, fair enough, but all you're doing then is just kind of articulating the statute itself, right? Okay, articulating the statute itself. How do we analyze whether something is a rule of practice and procedure? You know, in other words, does the law court give us any standard or rule or way of evaluating when something does or does not satisfy the Rules Enabling Act?
It is, well, I
Say that again? The test must be weather?
Yeah, the little subsection right in the middle of the test.
Yeah, I just read it out loud for everybody.
Okay, the test must be weather rule regularly, regulate procedure.
Whoa, slow yourself down, Senator.
Sorry.
Is a weather rule regularly regulates procedure?
Yes.
No. Yeah, not regularly regulates procedure, but really regulates procedure. So, what does that mean? How do we know? So, it's the standard here, the analysis, not whether the rule regulates procedure, but whether it really regulates procedure. So, does the court expand upon what that might really mean?
They say, you know, does the process actually enforce rights, or does it enforce duties recognized by the substantive law?
Okay, very good. Yeah. Yeah, and by the way, this cite to Civic versus Wilson and Company, Civic was a very, very early case involving the validity under the REA of Rule 35, involving medical examinations in discovery. All right. The court gives us the REA right there. The court gives us the really regulates procedure standard right there. What else does the court have to say? Because after all, Stephanie, starting here, okay, on page 938, Hanna 1 starts, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it goes through the whole thing about the outcome determination and the twin aims of Erie and all of that, which ends on page 940. So let's move to 940 plus, all right?
Okay.
What does the court have to say on 940 plus about analyzing the validity of an FRCP rule?
They kind of switch from the REA, which is before 940, and it seems like they kind of go towards the Erie rule and apply the Erie rule in there now.
On what page is that?
On page 940. It's right at the end of Hanna 1, where it's like the bold, yeah, here.
What do you mean? There is a more fundamental flaw?
Yeah. It says that the Erie rule has never been invoked to avoid a federal rule.
Right. I think you're going off on a left turn there, Stephanie. The court here is saying that the line of cases involving Erie and York and Byrd and Hanna Part 1, that line of cases has never been used to void a federal rule. Now the court's starting its analysis of the validity of the federal rule itself. So Blake, language. What's key language here? What language helps us to tell when a rule of the FRCP is valid or not? Don't worry, Stephen, you're up in a moment.
Okay. When a situation is covered by one of the federal...
What paragraph are we in there, guy?
940.
Which paragraph?
Middle paragraph.
Nor has?
Yes, mm-hmm. But if you keep going down, it's...
We are reminded?
When a situation...
Right above that, I think. Sorry about that.
When a situation is covered.
Okay. You mean this clause right here, Blake?
Yeah.
All right, let's talk about this clause. First, note, you see something different here?
New pen.
This is a Surface 4 pen. I paid like 50 or 60 bucks for this puppy. And fail us not, oh noble pen. The situation is very different from a typical unguided Erie scenario. Remember how I said Hanna 1's also known as unguided Erie? Because the court says it there. So, when we talk about the line of cases involving York and Byrd in Hanna Part 1, those are cases involving judge-made federal procedural law, all right? It's also known as the modified outcome determination test, also known as Hanna 1, also known as twin aims, also known as unguided Erie. You will see it referred to as all of these things. Oh, I got one more. Policy Erie. Okay? Now, I don't care. If you're writing an essay, I don't care what you label it by, just as long as you accurately tell me what the rule is itself, right? But it is known by all these things. Well, what the court's analyzing here is not unguided, Erie. What does this clause mean, Blake? The court has been instructed to apply the federal rule and can refuse to do so only if the advisory committee, this court, and the Congress have erred in their prima facie judgment that the rule in question transgresses neither the terms of the Enabling Act nor constitutional restrictions. Explain. In an essay of no more than.
I think what they're trying to say is that, like, you know, if the court erred before, then they wouldn't be able to use that federal rule.
No. Stephen.
Yeah.
What's it mean? Stephanie, you're next.
So, under Hanna 2, if you're going to decide whether the FRCP will, in order to resolve that conflict, you look more to the constitutional authority and the statutory authority.
Well, now that's an interesting thought there, Stephen. Okay. Have we had any other things we've studied where something is valid only if permitted by the Constitution and some sort of statute or rule? Yeah, SMJ, a PJ, right? Well, the court here seems to be saying for an FRCP to be valid, it's got to satisfy both the Constitution and the REA, the Rules Enabling Act. Correct. All right. Now, what does the reference to prima facie, just got a attaboy, all right, from Blake? I agree. It was a good answer. All right. All three of you, all right, I want everybody to shine. But what does prima facie mean here? A prima facie judgment of the court, the Congress, and the advisory committee. What's prima facie mean? It means on its face, but more basically, what does it mean here?
Isn't it like the first ruling on the matter? Like the first case kind of dealing with it?
Yeah, Stephanie, what happens when somebody meets their prima facie burden? Say a plaintiff meets its prima facie burden.
They can proceed in the case. If they don't meet all the elements, a lot of times the other party can file for summary judgment.
Okay. So if I'm a plaintiff and I meet my prima facie burden, do I still have the burden or might it shift to somebody else?
No, it shifts.
Okay.
McDonald-Douglas-Burden.
All right, so here we have a very good. It's the same idea. All right, McDonald-Douglas-Burden-Shifting Framework. I went to law school, too. Okay. As opposed to the law, McDonald's-Douglas.
Yes.
Yes. All right, there's a judgment that the rule is valid, right? All right, who is it that made this judgment that an FRCP rule is valid? Before an FRCP rule goes into effect, you're watching at home. Who's made that judgment?
Congress.
Who else?
Federal.
Supreme Court. Who else?
Advisory committee.
Are any of those actors created by the Constitution? Congress and the Supreme Court, right? Yeah. So two of these three actors are constitutional, are of a constitutional level, right? Determinations by at least two branches of the government that the rule is valid under both the Constitution and the REA. And additionally, you have the judgment that the rule is valid by the advisory committee, okay? Think about all the scrutiny that goes into an FRCP rule before it goes into effect. You have the advisory committee, which is filled with judges, I think lawyers. I'm not an expert on the advisory committee, but I'm sure practitioners on it, a lot of judges on it, okay? A lot of very smart, very serious people look over a rule before even sending it up higher in the food chain. Of course, it eventually goes to the Supreme Court and the Congress as well. Are that many people going to screw up? I guess they could. Right? I guess they could, if the decision makers are all captured by a special interest, I guess it could happen, but gosh, what the court says here, is that deferential towards these branches or not deferential? What's that?
Deferential.
Yeah, it's pretty deferential. Let's say these actors, two of which are of constitutional stature, have determined this is okay. So, prima facie case of validity. In other words, the burden goes on the challenger to prove invalidity, right? Yeah, to prove invalidity. under both the Constitution and under the statute. Now, regarding the statute, Stephanie pointed us to the stuff at the beginning of the opinion, you know, the stuff about really regulates procedure. Now, we're going to revisit that when we get to what case further?
Shady
Grove, right? Shady Grove is going to talk about further regarding the proper test for the Rules Enabling Act. So we'll get back to that. There's additional language here, guys, on page 940 to 41, talking about when does a rule of the FRCP satisfy the Constitution, okay? Three of you, all of you, maybe I'll call in some more of you, all of you, look, not me, look at your book, all right? What does the court tell us regarding satisfying the Constitution? When do we know that an FRCP rule is valid under the Constitution? Constitution, Stephen?
Of the opinion.
Right.
It said, to hold that a federal rule of civil procedure will cease to function whenever it alters the mode of enforcing state-created rights due to disemboweling of the Constitution.
I'm sorry, where are we on page 940?
941.
Oh, 941?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Okay, 941.
Yeah.
The sentence above
the sentence.
Yeah. It's towards the, it's the bottom half of the paragraph that begins with Erie.
Okay.
To hold that a federal rule.
Yeah. Now, is this phrase talking about just the Constitution? Is it talking about the Enabling Act, or is it talking about both?
Both.
Both, right?
Another Constitution.
Yeah.
Power of the Constitution.
And this language might be relevant towards 207.2b as well, right? You can't have a rule that alters, abridges, modifies, or enlarges any substantive right. Okay, so that's helpful language, but I want you to go back to the bottom of 940 and work from there. My specific question is regarding the Constitution. Stephanie?
Would it be the reference to the necessary and proper clause?
All right, that's helpful. Necessary and proper clause. Is that an independent grant of power to the Congress? Congress shall have the power to make all laws necessary and proper to put into effect. An enumerated power? Like, for instance, could Congress create a law, say, regarding general health and welfare and cite the necessary and proper clause? Let's take a minute to remind yourselves of the necessary and proper clause. Here's a necessary and proper clause. Congress has the power to make all laws that are necessary and proper to carry into execution the foregoing powers. So is this an independent basis for lawmaking for the Congress? No. When the Congress uses this, what else does it have to point to? What's that? Yeah, foregoing power, right? Which might be one of the powers listed above, such as to constitute tribunals inferior to the Supreme Court. What's another power regarding court that Congress is given? Not in Article 1. Article 3, right? All right, now go back to the opinion. Go back to the opinion. In that clause that Stephanie's reading, does the Supreme Court refer just to the necessary and proper clause? Or does it refer to an additional part of the Constitution? Yes?
I believe it's above where it says, we're reminded by Erie the opinion, neither Congress nor the federal courts can, under guise of formulating rules of decision, fashion rules that are not supported by a grant of federal authority contained in Article 1 or some other section of the Constitution. In such areas, state law must govern because there can be no other law.
Okay, you're correct. For a rule of the FRCP to be valid, it has to comply with the Constitution, right? Mm-hmm. And the court there says we have to find somewhere in the Constitution that makes the rules okay. Now, Stephanie's pointed towards the necessary and proper clause, right? But does this paragraph refer to anything else besides the necessary and proper clause? Because we've determined with Stephanie that N and P by itself doesn't do anything. You have to tie necessary and proper to something else. Yes?
I think that in the part when it says, like, for the constitutional provision for the federal court system and talks about the necessary and proper clause, carries with it congressional power to make rules governing the practice and pleading.
That
he's talking about, like, whether the Congress has authority to enact the rule.
Well, think about the provisions of the Constitution that give Congress the power to create a federal court system. It's Article 1, Section 8, and Article 3 for lower courts, right? Mm-hmm. I then combine that with necessary and proper clause, all right? That gives Congress the power to create rules of practice and procedure in the federal courts. Now, think about what's done under the REA. Okay, as compared to Congress acting itself. Congress can pass procedural statutes. Congress has passed procedural statutes such as diversity statute, such as venue transfer, 1404, right? Such as the removal statute, such as supplemental jurisdiction statute, and a host of others. What's special about the REA is the Congress has delegated a subset of those powers to the federal courts. In the REA, the Congress is saying, hey guys, you know, I'm the Congress. Under Article 3 and Article 1 and necessary and proper, I've got all these superpowers to create rules of practice and procedure in the courts. And I've done this, and I will do this again. But under the REA, I'm going to give you, Supreme Court, the power to do this as well. You can create rules of practice and procedure in the federal courts, and here's the process by which you do it. And I, the Congress, have the final word because you have to send me your proposed new rules, and I have the right to reject them within 7 months. It's a delegation by the Congress. It's a statute created by the Congress that delegates from the Congress to the courts Congress's constitutional power to create rules of practice and procedure for the federal courts. And that constitutional power exists because of Article 3, Article 1, and so on and so forth. Now here's my next question. How do we know when a rule of the FRCP complies with the Constitution? Must it be completely procedural? What if it is a little bit procedural and a little bit substantive? Camille.
Well, I have the question actually, but in here it says like falling within the uncertain area between substance and procedure are rationally capable of classification as either.
Very good. So we are on the bottom of 940. All right, so all these powers, right, necessary and proper, and those other parts of the Constitution, give a congressional power to make rules regarding practice and procedure in the courts. Which includes a power to regulate matters which, though falling within the uncertain area between substance and procedure, are rationally capable of classification as either. This is what is referred to as arguably procedural, ergo constitutional. What does ergo mean? What's ergo? It's an app. You get it on your iPhone. What's ergo?
Therefore.
What's that?
It's like therefore.
It's therefore. Ergo is Latin. It means therefore. I don't know if it's actually an app, but it kind of sounds like the name of an app, doesn't it? Ergo, you know, when you need a cab, you just pull up Ergo and it gets you. Would Ergo be like Uber for planes, Ergo? Lame humor. Okay. So, is Rule 4 arguably procedural? Is it?
Yeah.
In what sense? What's that, Stephen?
It's part of the FRCP.
Okay, then I'm going to make a new FRCP that sets the duty of care for a railroad. Is that arguably procedural?
No.
So what makes Rule 4D arguably procedural? Daniel?
Okay, so it tells you how you have to serve the defendant, so that's part of what...
How you serve the summons and the complaint, right? Is it arguably substantive as well? You could argue that the state law is arguably substantive to some sense, right? and determining under what circumstances an executor can be sued, right? But it's pretty easy to conclude that Rule 4D, now Rule 4E, is arguably procedural. Mm-hmm. So you think that's something to keep in mind. An FRCP is presumed valid under both the Constitution and the RAA. An FRCP also satisfies the Constitution so long as it's arguably procedural. Regarding the REA, the opinion appears to tell us that it's got to really regulate procedure, right? Then we'll go to Shady Grove to further elucidate what the REA might mean. All right, let me ask you this. We have two tracks here, right? So let's pull up the Coggle. We know that step one is determine state law. Step two is determine the content of federal law. Step three is to determine the track to go on, right? What type of conflict do you have? You know, is it Constitution versus state law? Is it federal general common law versus state law? Is it federal judgment procedure versus state law? Is it the REA rule versus state law? Remember, REA rules are ones created pursuant to Section 2072. That's going to be the FRCP, rules of appellate procedure, rules of bankruptcy procedure, amendments to the rules of evidence, and so on. Okay? Well, what we're going to find in a minute is that sometimes you'll have a rule of the FRCP versus state law. The court might treat it as either a Hanna 1 or a Hanna 2. In fact, that's what Walker and Shady Grove are all about. All right? Supreme Court's not always been consistent on how to classify conflicts concerning rules of the FRCP, sometimes using Hanna 1 and sometimes Hanna 2. If you're in doubt, analyze the alternative, all right? But we know judge-made procedure, if we go down that track, we've got to do the twin aims analysis. On the other hand, we determine the conflict is between an REA rule and state law, we've got to do the Constitution and REA analysis. Okay? Now we're going to get back to this in a minute. This is what Walker and Shady Grove are about, in large part. Which track do we go down? What is the type of conflict? What different? But now let me ask you a question. Now this is an important question that allows us to move more deeply into what I just brought up. Are both tracks equally likely to lead to state law or federal law? Is one track more likely to lead to federal law? Is one track more likely to lead to state law? By tracks, I mean Hanna 1 versus Hanna 2, right? Hanna 1 versus Hanna 2. In general, are they both equally likely to lead to the use of state law? Everybody take a minute and think about it. Okay, so we're talking here about vertical conflicts of law, right? State law says one thing, federal law says another, and they're important enough that the parties are going to fight about which one to use. When we started off with York was, let's say, that door is state law and this door is federal law, all right? York said that whenever there's going to be a substantial difference in the outcome, use state law, right? So that was very deferential towards state law, leading to the absurdity of the red brief, blue brief hypo. Byrd seems to go back in the other direction, right? And Byrd says even if there's going to be a difference in the outcome, use federal law if there's some sort of countervailing concern that says use federal law, right? Maybe that pulls too far towards federal law. Maybe Hanna Part 1, you know, the unguided eerie, the modified outcome determination test, pulls us back somewhere here. I don't know where. I don't know if it's in the middle. I don't know if it's here. I don't know if it's there. But I think it's fair to say it's not way over there, state law, or way over here, federal law. All right? But what I am asking is Hanna 1 and Hanna 2, are Hanna 1 and Hanna 2 equally likely to lead to application of one law versus the other? Or is, say, is Hanna 1 more likely to lead to state law than Hanna 2? Or is Hanna 1 more likely to lead to federal law than Hanna 2? That was my question, right? I'll put differently, taking the same question and putting it yet a different way, is one test more deferential to federal law than the other test? Natasha?
Yes.
What do you think?
I think Hanna 1, on page 938 at the bottom, it says that Erie and his progeny demand that federal courts apply state law whenever applicable, whenever application of federal law in its stead will alter the outcome of the case. So
well, let's not go from that because that is the defendant's argument that we should apply York.
Oh,
so
my bad.
I think I know where you're going with that, but that's dangerous language because the court rejects that extreme version of outcome determination. Camille.
Well, I think that when I like read all the cases, what I analyze is like Hanna 1, like. It, under the analysis of Hanna 1, I think that we can apply a state law, like it's more toward a state law.
Which one, Hanna 1 or
Hanna 1.
Hanna 1's more towards state law than?
Yeah. Than Hanna 2.
Than Hanna 2. Okay, explain why.
Well, when I read all the cases, I see like the justices, and all, they were like very... they interpret the federal rules of civil or I don't know. It's like they are more toward to find like the federal rule valid and apply it to the cases.
Mm-hmm. But you mean an REA rule, right? FRCP rule.
Exactly. Yes.
Yeah. By the way, you are correct. You are undoubtedly correct. Please continue.
Okay. And I think that in Hanna 2, if in Hanna 1, if when they're doing the analysis, I think that when the policies, if ignoring the state law and applying the federal instead, this is complicated, but I have it. Okay.
I haven't stopped you.
Okay. I think that when that federal rule violates, let's say, like the Erie policy.
Yeah, and the Erie policy of Erie is what?
Well, we have the discourage inequitable administration of law and avoid foreign shopping. Okay, I think that when we measure like the this policy and the court is doing that, he can find like, okay, if we apply the federal rules, here we can open the door to like plaintiff to come here and litigate in here. We can like find a lot of results, like prohibit the court to apply the federal rules. And well, apply the state. So
I like everything you were saying. I thought it was beautiful. I'm going to stop you when you start moving to the federal rules because now you're kind of jumping from Hanna 1 analysis into Hanna 2 analysis. Yeah. Let's stop with the federal, with the Hanna 1 analysis. You're absolutely correct. Hanna 1 is much more likely to lead to the application of state law than Hanna 2. In fact, think of Shady Grove. All right? Scalia and Stevens both say the conflicts between an REA rule and state law, and the REA is not violated, and therefore use federal law. Justice Ginsburg in dissent says this is a Hanna 1 analysis. She applies the twin aims, said using federal law will lead to form shopping, and therefore we must use the state law. Okay? Hanna Part 1, much more likely to lead to state law. Now let's think of why. Well, first of all, forum shopping, is that a part of the Hanna 2 analysis?
No.
Yeah, it's not, right? But it is Hanna 1, all right? For Hanna 1 type scenario, who made the federal law? Yeah, a judge, or maybe the Supreme Court, the decision, or a panel of appellate judges, or maybe just a district court judge, right? Has the law there been gone through that multi-level process, the advisory committee, the Supreme Court, and the Congress?
No.
No, so we're not going to accord prima facie validity to it. It's just judge-made procedural law, okay? Now, on the other hand, with the FRCP, that rule has been vetted through multiple layers of very qualified thinkers, two of which are constitutional branches of the government, and they are going to be presumed to be valid. And you would imagine the Supreme Court would be very hesitant to invalidate one of its own rules of procedure that it made through the rules amendment process, right? So, how many times has the Supreme Court invalidated one of its own REA rules? Hasn't happened yet, right? It hasn't happened yet. So Stevens is probably more willing to invalidate a rule than Scalia is, right? But it hasn't happened yet. Thus, to an extent, the kind of standard of review you use, the track you go down, is in itself likely to be outcome determinative. And here I mean determining which law you use, right? Not the result of the case outcome determination, but outcome determination in the sense of do you use federal law or state law in that vertical conflict. If you go down the Hanna 1 track, there's a good chance we'll end up using state law, you know, if there's going to be forum shopping or inequitable administration or both, state law. If you go to the Hanna 2 track, then it's very unlikely we're going to be using state law at all, and we don't give a hoot about forum shopping. Okay, so very good. And I know several of you also had your hands up, so thank you for that as well. With that in mind, let's move into the Walker case for just a moment. Now, Walker is a case that illustrates the indeterminacy of whether we go down the Hanna 2 track, that's the REA analysis, or Hanna 1 track, that's the twin aims analysis. In the Walker case, the dispute seemed to involve FRCP 3. The civil action is commenced by filing a complaint with the court. Okay? You may have always assumed, and plausibly, reasonably, that once you file a complaint with the court, that any applicable statute of limitation is told, satisfied. However, some states require not just filing, but also service. And unless you have service, then the statute of limitations has not yet been met. So in Walker, we have the following fact pattern. Super duper simple fact pattern. Complaint is filed. That's one. Statute of limitation expires. That's two. After the statute of limitations expires, service on the defendant. That's number three. Under the federal way of treating Rule 3, the statute of limitations would be satisfied. But under the applicable state's treatment, the statute of limitation would have expired prior to the tolling of the statute of limitations. So, you know, if we use REA analysis, it would seem that Rule 3 would trump state law, right? Of course, now if we use Hanna Part 1 analysis, Twin Aims analysis, it would appear that we'd have to use state law, right? So which analysis do we use? And the court holds, which analysis do we use?
Hanna 1.
Yeah, Hanna 1 analysis, right? Twin Aims analysis. The court said that even if the difference in laws won't lead to forum shopping. Nonetheless, that will be a very inequitable administration of the laws. Think of it. In federal court, plaintiff might win. In state court, the case is immediately over in a major way. The interesting question is why the court concludes that this is a Hanna 1 case and not a Hanna 2 case. Well, for one thing, is there anything in this rule regarding the effect of filing on the SOL? Does it say anything like that? Dario?
Well, it doesn't say anything specifically, but it says that if the document is commenced by filing the case, so I would imagine the statute of limitations starts to run when the civil action is commenced.
Yeah, you know what, Dario says that since the word commenced is in there, that he would imagine, and I too would imagine, that a reasonable reading would be that means the statute of limitations is satisfied, because this case has commenced, started, right? And in fact, if you're in federal court on a federal cause of action, that is the law. However, if you're in state court, excuse me, if you are in federal court on a state cause of action, that's not the law, right? And the court gives us the reason that the rule is actually silent regarding the effect of filing the complaint upon the statute of limitations, right? In other words, the Supreme Court read Rule 3 very narrowly to deal with only the commencement of the suit, which triggers for certain timing obligations, and not to have anything to deal with any tolling of a statute of limitations. One of the timing requirements that's triggered by filing the complaint with the court is what has to happen after filing the complaint? Service within how many days?
60 days.
What's the time for serving the complaint and summons?
90 days.
90 days, Rule 4M, that's correct. Okay. Again, that tells us that when we are in a scenario involving federal and state law, you think, oh, an REA rule is involved. Rule 3, right? But you actually have to think about whether to interpret or construct the rule narrowly or broadly. In Walker, the court read the rule very narrowly, and what you thought would be a Hanna Part 2 REA analysis instead became a Hanna Part 1 Twin Aims analysis. And that should tell you something very important, which is when your case involves an REA rule, well, think about, does the REA rule unambiguously cover the issue at hand? If not, you may have to argue in the alternative. Now, to illustrate this, let's turn to the problem set. So we have problems 7, 8, and 9. 7 should sound familiar to you. Rule 3 states a civil action is commenced by filing a complaint with the court. State court rules say the SOL is told only by the service, right? Which one do you use? Does that remind you of any cases? Yeah. Question 6 is just Walker using the characters from The Simpsons. Question 8 is more interesting. Suppose the Congress amends FRCP. I actually shouldn't say Congress here. Let me change this one a little bit. The Supreme Court, through the rule amendment process, okay, I think that clarifies this better. Oh, that doesn't close it. Let's try this one. All right. Supreme Court amends Rule 3 to say a civil action is commenced by filing a complaint with the court. Moreover, any such filing shall toll any applicable statute of limitations. Which law should the court apply? Amended Rule 3 or state law? Yes.
I think Rule 3, because now it unambiguously addresses the issue.
Yeah. Now it doesn't seem like we would need to analyze the alternative. It seems like Rule 3 on its face, without any ambiguity, covers the situation, right? So now we have to ask whether or not we deviate from our prima facie judgment that the rule is valid under the Constitution and the REA. All right. Does this rule arguably cover procedure?
Yes.
In what sense?
In the sense that a civil action is commenced and such filing shall toll any applicable statute.
Oh, but you're answering the question just by reading the rule back to me. Let's ask the class. In what sense is this amended rule? Yes?
It's procedural because it goes to like the timeline of the case.
Yeah, like by when you would have to file, right? It's not about whether you actually satisfied, say, like a tort claim. It's about when you would have to file it, right? That's arguably procedural, all right? It was also arguably substantive, which is probably what Brenda was struggling with, right? But it is also arguably procedural. The harder question is going to be whether or not it really regulates procedure and whether it abridges amends or enlarges any substantive right. That's a much harder question, right? So let's go this far in our analysis, Brenda. Is this modified rule more likely or less likely to apply than the version in question 7? Which one is more likely to be used by the court?
The federal court?
Yeah. Would the federal court be more likely to use federal law in question 7? Or in question 8?
In question 8.
Yeah, in question 8, right? Because question 7 requires twin aims analysis, which here is going to be very deferential towards state law because of the forum shopping and more likely the inequitable administration of laws. Mm-hmm. Question 8 is a closer call, and we very well may end up applying it federal law as opposed to state law. How about question 9? All right? Springfield common law says a bartender is strictly liable to any person for harm caused by a bar owner to a plaintiff, okay, when the harmful acts were proximately caused by the consumption of alcohol. In contradiction, we have hypothetical FRCP 100 that says there's no liability caused by a drunken patron unless the bartender knew or had reason to know that the drunk person was drunk before leaving the bar. So state law is a strict liability standard. All right, to mow the bartender. Federal law is a knowledge-based standard, right? The defendant has to have known that the guy was drunk before leaving the bar, okay? Now, first of all, does the rule govern the situation? Does Rule 100 govern the situation? Does it unambiguously cover the same situation as the state law? It has to. Can strict liability exist without knowledge by the defendant?
Yeah.
Strict liability is you've done the deed, you're liable. You didn't have to intend to cause harm. You just have to have done the act. Okay? So there's a square conflict. So we've got to do REA analysis, okay, and not twin aims analysis. All right. First step. Is the rule valid is it presumed valid? Yes, because it went through the rulemaking process. Next step. Is the rule arguably procedural?
No.
Yeah, it's not arguably procedural at all. It's a substantive tort standard, right? All right? And even then, even if you could argue it's arguably procedural, it would seem to enlarge or bridge or modify rights. So it seems very likely that in question number 9, the rule would be invalid. Okay? And there's a reason why you don't see rules like this made under the FRCP. Because they do go through the process. People do take the process very seriously. Now, I will admit, and sometimes procedural law can have substantive effects in a major way. And sometimes procedural law can actually mask a hidden substantive objective. You might accuse the Iqbal standard of being substance masked as procedure, right? Are we concerned about there being too many suits against the government or too many suits against big companies for consumers, for too many class actions, and the like. Well, instead of changing tort law, why don't we change procedural law to make the tort claims harder to pursue, right? So, have no doubt, and I think that gets back a little bit to what you were thinking about, Brenda, when we were talking about this a moment ago. Oftentimes, procedural law has substantive effects or even substantive motivations to it. And that term harkens back to what Justice Reed said in his concurrence in Erie versus Tompkins, that the line between substance and procedure is hazy, right? So these cases bring that up. Now, let's move into the Shady Grove case. So let's turn to that. I'm going to start off with facts and then Scalia, Stevens, and Ginsburg. Three of the most interesting justices on recent Supreme Courts. Unfortunately, two of them are no longer on the court. Justice Scalia having passed away, as you well know, very recently. Okay, let's see. Michael, very briefly tell me about the facts of Shady Grove.
So, Shady Grove is a healthcare provider, and they are suing against Allstate after there was a claim, basically, one of the women they were caring for, she suffered some trauma in an automobile accident, and her bills were assigned to Allstate. So, they tried to make their claim through Allstate.
That's right.
Get that money, and it would be very small, if they were making it on their own, but they had instead they have a class action against Allstate, which basically everyone that is owed money from Allstate, they're all suing together in this big class action.
Okay, very good. If there's a class action, is there going to be SMJ?
Yeah.
Under what basis? 1332A? Right. 1332A?
1332A.
So, but 1332A doesn't allow aggregation of separate claims, right?
Sure.
How much is Shady Grove's claim worth?
Shady Grove's is $500.
And the amount of controversy is?
75K.
Over 75K, right?
Yeah, over
75. Okay. What about 1332D?
1332D.
Class Action Fairness Act, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
That allows for if it's. It's over 5 million.
Okay. That's 5 million aggregated, right?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Is the aggregated value of the class action exceed the amount of controversy?
Yes.
Yeah. So if we can have a class action, there's SMJ. If we can't have a class action, there's no SMJ, and the case must be dismissed for lack of SMJ. That's what the lower court did, right? All right, now let's look at the two laws here. Note that Rule 23 talks about the types of class actions that can be maintained, right? Rule 23 also talks about numerosity, commonality, typicality, and representation, right? Just like New York law, Section 901A. Now, you don't have 901A. 901B is the one in your book, and 901B is the one that's at issue here, right? And it, too, talks about what types of class actions may or may not be maintained, right? So, for purposes of this case, Michael, what is the big difference between 901B, state law, and Rule 23?
Rule 23 doesn't specify anything about penalties, whereas Rule 901B is talking specifically about the remedy type, that they don't want penalties to cause exorbitant fees from class actions.
That's right. How much is the case worth if it's just Shady Grove versus Allstate?
$500.
About $500. But it's worth millions if the claim is aggregated pursuant to the Class Action Fairness Act 1332D, if the various claims. Okay. Say you are the lawyer representing Shady Grove.
Okay.
Would you want to file in state court?
No.
Why not?
Because your action can't be maintained under matter 1B.
So you can't have a class action. Oh, you can have an action.
Oh, you can have an action.
And how much would it be worth?
$500.
Worth $500, right? Can you do a class action in New York State Court?
Yeah.
Oh, you can?
Oh, no, you can't.
Yeah, not under these facts. You can't because of 901B. But if we're in federal court, and the federal court uses Rule 23 and doesn't use 901B, then that can be pursued in federal court. Now, if you're all state, right, you either want to be in New York court, right, or you want the federal court to use 901B, okay? So it's obvious here why the plaintiff's lawyer chose federal court. All right, when we're in a scenario where we don't know whether to use HANA 1 track or HANA 2 track, the first thing we need to do is determine the scope and content of the federal law. In other words, does the FRCP rule govern the situation? Or are we really just dealing with judge-made federal procedural law, such as a judge-made gloss on Rule 3, right? Walker, Rule 3 wasn't in conflict with state law. Instead, it was a federal judicial judge-made law gloss on Rule 3, and they used HANA Part 1. Well, how does Scalia interpret Rule 23? Does it conflict with state law?
Scalia says it conflicts, yeah.
Yeah. In what sense? Or senses? Why is there a conflict?
In that Rule 23 is talking about how you can maintain a federal a class action.
Okay. And, what page are you on? 956? Okay.
Both of the bottom of the first paragraph, full paragraph on the page, both of 901 subsections undeniably. Yeah.
No, I like that. You mean this?
Yeah, undeniably answer the same. Yeah.
They address the same thing. Of course, the dissent is saying, well, Rule 23 is about how you maintain a class action, whereas 901B is about the remedy that's available, right? Yeah, Scalia doesn't buy that, does he? What about the purpose of 901B, Michael? Isn't the purpose of 901B to prevent class actions from having these punitive aggregated levels of damages such that Allstate's not hit for $500, it's hit for $5 million? Oh my goodness, how awful is that?
Yeah, that's the exact purpose.
Okay, yeah, maybe you're right. Maybe. Yeah, I think you're right. I think you're right. Does Scalia look to the purpose of the act?
No.
Well, why not? What does he look at?
Purpose of the rule. Rule 23 is purpose.
No. Does he look to the purpose of Section 901?
Oh, no.
No, why not?
Because that's irrelevant to him, basically.
Yeah, it kind of is. What does he look at? What's important to Justice Scalia?
Rule 23 only.
I know the language that you're talking about, but that's not actually responsive to my question. Let's avoid that right now. I think that you're looking at the end of towards the end of his opinion. No. Does he look to the purpose of the law? What to him is the most important thing in determining the meaning of Section 901B? The congressional purpose? Legislative purpose, rather? Let's get Michael co-counsel on this one. Stephen.
In the end of Part B, Justice Scalia says...
Page, please. No. No, that's the language that Stephen, that Michael was just talking about.
In some?
No. You know, you're referring to the same language that Michael was talking about as well. No, we're on page 958, I assure you. Yes.
statutes, the clear text.
Yeah.
I guess it's like two paragraphs or three paragraphs up from the bottom.
Yeah, it's the beginning of the second paragraph on 958. Scalia doesn't give a flying hoot about the legislature's objectives as contained in things like legislative history. The only thing he cares about is the text of the statute. And this is one of the most important things you get out of this case, beyond the stuff about Erie and REA and all that stuff. One of Scalia's lasting accomplishments as a jurist is his repeated holdings that when engaging in statutory construction, your primary source of the statute's meaning is its text itself. If the meaning of the text is clear and unambiguous on its face, then we do not look to legislative history or conference reports or committee reports or anything like that. We look to the language itself. Now, not all judges or justices will agree with Justice Scalia. Justice Breyer, in fact, wrote in one of his books that it's important to look at things like legislative intent. But Scalia doesn't look at things like legislative history. All he cares about is the text. He looks at the text and determines that there's a conflict between Rule 23 and Section 901B. Okay? Now, that is in part 2A of the opinion. All right? The reason I rejected the language Stephen and Michael were pointing to is because that comes from part 2B of the opinion. Okay? Now, Michael, what's the issue in Rule 2, Part 2B of the opinion?
Part 2B of the opinion is all about the analysis he's using on why this, what he's looking at as far as actual being the federal rule there. So looking at Congress and its powers and then looking at where it affects the, you know, procedural law.
Well, that's kind of, that's not as clear as we want it to be. If part 2A is about, is there a conflict between state law and federal law, okay? In other words, if there's a conflict between a federal rule and state law, and he concludes that there is, then part B is about
resolving it,
right? Or determining which one to use, right? Okay, and here he engages in Rule Enabling Act analysis. Now, in part 2B, what is the rule? How do you analyze the Rules Enabling Act according to Justice Scalia in part 2B?
The test is not whether the rule affects the litigants examined by its most procedural rule too.
What page are you on a page?
Yeah, I'm on 960 here.
Good, 960 is a good page.
The test is not whether the rule affects the litigants.
Which paragraph?
The first paragraph.
Okay, good.
The middle of it, yeah. Yeah, it's not whether it affects a litigant's substantive rights, as most procedural rules do. What matters is what the rule itself regulates. It governs only the manner and the means by which the litigant's rights are enforced. It is valid.
Yeah, and in addition, I'll also add to that, Michael, the very first sentence where he repeats the language from Hanna and Civic, right? The rule must really regulate procedure, right? And he doesn't care if the rule affects substantive rights, all right, because most procedural rules do. And ultimately, he concludes that Rule 23 is really about, it's a joinder rule, right? Just like Rule 18 or Rule 20. It doesn't determine what the rights are, it determines the means by which you enforce the rights. And indeed, even in New York State Court, you could sue Allstate for $500. You could sue Allstate for $600. You could sue Allstate for $700. You could sue Allstate for $10, all in separate suits. You still have that right. New York courts don't let you do it all together in one suit, but in federal courts, has a different joinder rule. And in federal court, you can all join together as members of a class, right? Now, let's just ask one more question to close out today's discussion, because it provides a good bookend to the rule that Michael just gave us. Does Stevens view the REA the same way that Scalia does? Or does Stevens interpret the REA very differently? Differently, right? How?
Stevens
do more of the part, the 27.2 lead analysis.
That's right. Under 2072B, we have to ask whether Rule 23 abridges, enlarges, or modifies any substantive right. Put differently, what Stevens says about Scalia is Stevens accuses Scalia of ignoring 2072B, reading it out of the statute, rendering it surplusage that means anything. As says Stevens, that the really regulate procedure test used by Scalia does the whole thing. So long as something really regulates procedure, then that's the end of the analysis. And Stevens says, no, you have to continue and do the whole analysis. Okay, we have some more stuff to say about this case and to tie it all together. All right, so let's hold off on that. I believe we've done our 75 minutes, right? So we started at 3:30, we're ending a minute or two after 4:45. Seems like a fair place to stop. I know you guys have had a long day today, so thank you very much for coming to the late class. I greatly appreciate your time. I'll see you guys on Wednesday. Thank you.